Good evening, everyone. Okay, today I'm going to post my second video and I'm going to analyze a book by Auxin Semben, that is God's Bits of Wood. This book is written it takes place in Senegal town, that is in Thais, and a lot of stuff happens in Thais, and almost half of the book, or rather three quarter of the book, all the happenings are happening in Thais, then later to Dakar. This book involves a lot of issues are happening in the book. Like we can see, God's Bits of Wood. This is a community that believes that even if they are mistreated in the society, they believe that it's the will of God. That's why I see the title is named God's Bits of Wood, because they are satisfied, they are contented with whichever thing that happens in the society, and they don't even bother if it can be changed or not. It's not their business, and that's what happens in the society. But now one person rises, that is Bakayoko, who decides that now we are tired of living this life, we want to make a change in the society. And Bakayoko begins a strike, which ironically is not part of it, because a lot of stuff happens, but Bakayoko is not in it. It's not available, or it's not at that position. Bakayoko mostly is a way while all these things happens, and it features later in the story. Bakayoko features later during the time that women were planning to go for the march, the strike, so that there can be respect. So this society, there are two people involved. There is the rich, there is the haves, and that we have the poor, that is the have nots. These are the two society, the two people, there are two people involved, the two persons in the story, and we can really see it from the life of Isnad. Isnad is among the people that are at the haves. They have everything in the society. They mistreat people, and you find out that it's all ironical that these people who have most of their wealth are created by them that does not have. And these people are working in their farms, working in the railway roads and everything, but they are mistreated, they're not paid whatever they should be paid. And just a lot happens. And this, you can see in the book, these people are organizing for a strike, which they decide that those people that are working in the railway should stop. And then those people that are working even in the farms and everywhere, every place, they should stop the work so that they can go on strike. And they decide, of course, in the society you can agree on a certain stuff, but there are some people who will go and do according to the desire of everyone, or the rule that has been spoken or said, but some people are going to be against it. So in this society you find that there are some people who could still go to work, but they come back at night when nobody was seeing them, and they were also noticed at the end. And then there are some people who now they decided that even if my family is going to suffer, we are not going to have anything to eat, nothing to bring on the table for my children, I'm not going to work. Because now they wanted some freedom. Because these people, they came to colonize, the colonizers came to this place, they instilled a lot of rules on them, the rules that they never used to live with. And now that's why I started by saying that this book is representing two people. Two persons, that is the haves and the have-nots in the society. And then the family of Isnad, that is Isnad together with the wife Beatrice, these are the people that have everything in the society that is needed. And then we have that family, that the family which belongs to the society, the people that are the have-nots in the society. These people are really suffering. We see the Rama, we see the likes of Daye, we see the likes of Mem Sophie. There are a lot of people in the society that are really suffering, but Kfaketa, and what are they doing in return? They decide to begin a strike. And in this strike, they begin it because now they want, it's a sort of ideology, they want something, or rather freedom in their country, because they are living in their country, but the colonizers or the, these people that came, the Isnad and Beatrice, they are really depriving them of their rights, and a lot of stuff happen, and you can find out that they are really even going hungry because they can't be paid what is enough. You know, in this society they believe that polygamy was key, and you can find that in one family there's also this one man is marrying like 9 wives in this family, and this one is really causing a lot of trouble because Isnad says that he can't pay them because he doesn't know which family to support, which home, which house, which wife. And you can imagine with the 9 wives, all of them with the children, and then with one husband, and Isnad claims that it's really impossible to really support them. And it, because they organized for a strike, these people are so organized, and they really punish the lawbreakers. And in the case, we can see Diarra is one of them. Diarra rebels and never wants to go their way and decide that no, I'm going this other way. And in the life of Diarra, he decided, because after all you can see the suffering in the society, you can even decide that even if the society will not take me as theirs, I will not go with them, because no, my family, I can't see my family suffering. So they decide, Diarra decides to go the different route, the different direction. And because Diarra decides to take a different route, it's really punishable in the society, because they agreed as one community. They are so united in this community, they are so united, the ties, they are united, and they decide that if you're not going our way, then there's a punishment. And in the moment when they decide that no, we are going to punish them, that is the time when we see that Faketa, during the meeting, Faketa rises up and says that no, it's not supposed to be punished, like be beaten or be hung, because that was their way of doing it. That Diarra should just be given a punishment. That is psychological torture, which will torture him for the rest of his life. And then after that, after everyone had suggested everything, they agree on doing the same. And because of that, Diarra really suffers psychological torture, because you can imagine you are humiliated in front of your child. In that meeting, it was said that Diarra went to the meeting together with the son, and then the son there could not. Even the child was psychologically tortured because he could not take it. His father being embarrassed in front of him, and that was enough for the torture. And now Diarra, thereafter, we see that Diarra falls sick, and all that really means that it really worked, the way of punishment. And these people are so organized that even they plan everything, and if you break the rules of the strike, or rather the rules that have been made in the society, you are to be punished. And this really made the strike really to augur well. At the end of the strike, we can see they got what they really wanted. They achieved whatever was the reason as to why they created the strike. And that is really evident. Okay, the men decided to strike, and the women could release their children to go back, to go roam around the roads, roam around and look for something that they can bring home so that they can eat, because they're really suffering. And that's the expense of the life of Rama. Rama also meets a brother on the road after going to borrow some rice so that she can cook for the children, but she's denied of her rice because now she doesn't have money to pay back. And what where are you going to get the money to pay me back? I can't lend you anything. And then she's not lending anything, but on the way she meets a brother who is working with these people, who are working with this Isnad and Beatrice. And again, the brother decided that no, I won't lend you. Then Rama decided that okay, if you're doing this to me, never talk to me again. I'm going back to my home, and I know what I'm going to do. Rama decides in one evening and takes a knife and goes to Vendetti, that was the ram, and kills it so that the whole village can have a peace, so that they cannot die, something to sustain them. And in the process of doing that, Rama comes to an end of everything, comes to an end, that Rama is so much injured that Rama has blood all over the body because of the vein. You can imagine that is a very big ram that Rama goes as a woman to kill it. And then everyone is just contented with it. They feel that if God wanted us to be this way, then it's the will of the Lord. I have nothing to do about it. But he goes against it. And he said, enough is enough. My children cannot die. Because she was asked the reason as to why she did what she did. And this is what Rama said, that I looked at the kitchen, nothing to cook, and the coldness in the kitchen made me to do that. So you can imagine, the kitchen was cold, to mean there was no cooking taking place, and for a very long time they never cooked anything in that kitchen, and the children were really suffering, and everyone in the society. But the men were striking, and in the midst of the strike, you can see that some men are captured and tortured somewhere else, and this really triggers them, and they really want to continue. It acts like a catalyst, because they really want to achieve something, and these people still torture them. It really takes a different route in the society. And then after Rama is now taken captive because of the act that she did in the society, just to defend the community and just to fight for them, the less they have not, so that they can have something to eat, so that they cannot die. And Rama now is taken captive, and the family is just left alone behind. Remember, the men are fighting, are striking, they're not going to work, there's nothing, really nothing in the society for them. And then these women are really tired with everything that is happening, and they say that, okay, now we want to begin Women March. And all women agree that they're going to march. That is, they're led with different people. For instance, Penda, who was known as the prostitute in the society. Penda is the one who is leading now this strike, this march. And they're now marching from Thais to Dakar. And you can imagine one of the characters says that from Thais to Dakar is a distance that not even a man can walk and reach there alive. So you can imagine these women are really risking, and they want to go to Dakar, that is the town, so that they can fight, they can join the men in fighting and all that. They decide to have the march, they move there. We have the Maimuna, the witch, we have Penda. A lot of women decide that now we are going, no matter the challenges, because on the way there were a lot of challenges. And even in Thais, they had to defend themselves. There's a time they were attacked together with the camels, and they realized that these camels, they really fear light. So they decided that if this is the way, we are going to do the other way. And they really defeated them. And so you can imagine the challenges that they are undergoing during the march. There's no water, there's no food, you are hungry, and you have to walk a distance that, remember, not even a man can reach to Dakar when he is still alive. So they're really risking, because they really want something. They want peace, they want their freedom back. And they are really tired, because they can imagine that their husbands can also hold the same position that Isnad is holding in the society, so that they can at least have something for them in the table. And in this society, again, we see like they really don't accept education. Education is not, like, they really don't go with that. You can see Ndeye's approach to civilization. Ndeye goes to school, Ndeye on science class, and they are taught how to sew, and they are taught how to mend a brazier. And Ndeye decides that, okay, I am going to do something, because Ndeye never wanted to look like the grandmother. So she decided that, no, I'm going to make a brazier for myself. And in school, Ndeye could proudly put on this brazier. But out of school, whenever Ndeye reached home, she decided that, now I'm going to hide it under my bed, because now it's something that is not heard of in the society. No one does that. And now you're coming back after education, the civilization, you're coming back with something new. And her approach to civilization really takes a different route. In return, it leads to embarrassment. As Mem Sophie comes in and finds putting on that brazier and decides to call everyone. You can imagine everyone, because this society were living peacefully and were living together. So everything that happened, it was shared to everyone. So you can imagine everyone is called so that they can show you to them. And this happens to Ndeye, it leads to embarrassment. On the other hand, Ndeye is also in love with Bakayoko. Bakayoko is a married man, and education, according to Ndee, teaches Ndee that she should not marry to a person or a man with a wife that is polygamy. Education and civilization is against polygamy. And Ndee, according to her, she knows that I will never, and that is whatever she decided, that never, she's never going to marry a man with a wife. And now what happens in the society, Ndee is in love with Bakayoko. On the other hand, Baguz is also in love with Ndee. This is a man who is educated, very learned, a man who has no wife, nothing to, no obstacle, we can call it. And now you can imagine Ndee has to face all this, decide to live alone, the education, the civilization of not marrying in a polygamous family. And now Ndee is in love with Bakayoko, and Bakayoko, Ndee is now decides that after Bakayoko reappears before the match, Bakayoko now reappears in the, remember, Bakayoko begins the strike and now reappears at the end when everything is now going to the end, the ship is now going to the shore, and you can imagine that's now when Bakayoko arrives in the village of Thais. And now here they decide that okay, I have my feelings and I want to express them, and then Ndee expresses her feelings to Bakayoko. And in return, what does Bakayoko do? Bakayoko decides that okay, I am married. And in fact, he was not even committed to the wife. Bakayoko is the father to Ajibiji, as the name suggests. And now Bakayoko is not even committed. He's carried out with a lot of stuff that is happening, that even forgets the family. And now this another woman wants Bakayoko to marry her. It's really hard. And Bakayoko decides, no, I'm not going with that. And because of this disappointment and displaced feelings, Ndee decided that now I want to isolate everything and just do whatever other women are doing in the society. And now Ndee decides that I'm going the way of the grandma, the Mem Sophie. And Ndee decides that okay, it's okay, you've decided that you don't want us to be together. This is what I will do. I will just leave it at that point. And then that's where Ndee decides to live now a miserable life, as we can say. Ndee lives a very miserable life. And then after that, we also see Penda. Mem Sophie really describes Penda as someone who is a prostitute, but in the real sense, Penda does what she does because of the home or the house, the family she's coming from. They don't have anything to eat. There's just a lot and the hunger in the family. And she decides that, okay, now what I'm going to do is just simple. I'm going to look for men. They give me money. So Mem Sophie now describes this woman, Penda, as a prostitute. And then Maimuna, the witch, is also, this novel literally takes a very big role in this novel, because you find out that Maimuna in the novel does the role of healing the sick. Like if you were sick, Maimuna knew some drugs and leaves that could help you, the herbs that could help you get back. And that is also evident during the match, that someone falls sick and she treats the person and they come back to their food. And now Maimuna has a child. At first she had two children, and one of them died during the strike, and now they're in the match. She has the baby. She doesn't know even the father, because now she's blind, and she claims that she cannot see, but her eyes were replaced by the ears. So we can see that in the novel, Maimuna really suffers, because she has to join the strike, because that is the rule, and number two, that is what she really wanted. But again, you can see she's really suffering, because she's seeing nothing. She's blind, and remember that walking, just roaming around the street, and you are blind carrying your baby. It was so hectic, and it really needed a lot of energy. And another person that I really reflected in the book that you can really see. The Mem Sophie, you can see this is a person, a woman that really the book describes as a sharp tongued. Mem Sophie really speaks about everything and anything and not even caring about the feelings of anyone. And even during the time that they decided that she's going to live a miserable life, you can see whatever Mem Sophie says that you can also do this, you can also, and a lot is really happening in the book. It's a book of my liking, actually. And so, again, we can see that the strike in this society really worked. Can you see that the strike really worked because these people were so united? They were doing everything together, like everyone together. They were united, like everyone in the society was equal, and they were now focusing towards the goal that was the strike, so that at the end of the strike they can get their freedom. And you can see that at the end they achieved what they really wanted, because you see that at the end, Isnad and Beatrice, finally they leave. Beatrice is killed in the process, and now Isnad has to leave. And now their men had to take the positions they really wanted them to take. So this is a book that really describes, we can talk of Marxist theory. Marxist talks about the classes in the society, the haves and the have-nots, and it really focuses on that. That's so evident in the book. So it's a book of my liking, and it has a lot of lessons, because a lot of people in the society, even if they undergo whatever, they are contented with the situation, that they really, really don't want any change. And so the ideology of striking at the end really bared fruit, and you can see that finally they got what they really wanted. And amidst everything, we can see that it's a really rich book. Okay, it's huge one, it's a big book, but it's really rich with everything that Alana, or someone who is interested in knowing much about different countries, can really bank on. It's a book that really describes how these people mistreat the haves, mistreat the have-nots, and they really work for them. They have, it's ironical that they work for them, and at the end, these people are the people that are going richer and richer, wealthier, and you're remaining at the same place, at the same position, with nothing changed, and your life just the same. Okay, that's I can call that the end. It really has a lot, and that is all at the moment that I can tell you. If you really want to know more about the book, it's a very nice book, captured in Senegal. Okay, in the village of Thais, and later in Dakar, and there's a lot of happenings in the book. You can just go read the book. It's a rich book. You will love it. It's boring at the beginning, but you will like it when you get to proceed. Okay, it's a really nice book, and I will keep posting more books. So kindly subscribe to my YouTube channel so that you can continue getting the new books. And if you have any suggestion of the book that I should analyze, you can just comment down below. I shall get it and analyze it for you, so that it can make the reading even easier. Thank you. And subscribe to my YouTube channel. I love you all. Subscribe, leave a comment, and ensure that you press the bell button. Thank you.